Hello, I'm Kevin Morales, editor-in-chief with the Cayman Compass. Thanks so much for joining us today on our Ask the Experts Roundtable. We've got a good one in store for you today. It's the state of the media, and I have an esteemed panel of journalists waiting here to give their two cents on everything that's happening with media locally and abroad. We plan on talking about coverage. We plan on talking about financing models. We plan on talking about the public's trust in the media and everything in between. So we're gonna have a really great chat with you here today. Without further ado, let me introduce you to our panel. And automatically on the screen right away is somebody who many of you in the Cayman Islands will recognize. That is April Cummings. She is the news director with Radio Cayman. Let me tell you who else we're going to be hearing from today. We've got Tammi Sulliman. Tammi is the former station manager at Cayman 27. And has also worked with some other media outlets here in the Cayman Islands. We'll be joined by Patrick Brendel. He is the founder and editor of the Cayman Current, which is really an interesting startup. It's going to be a nonprofit news organization focusing specifically on education here in the Cayman Islands. We'll be joined, or we are joined, by former WestStar CEO Bob Taylor, who has also worked with the Cayman Reporter. We are joined by Pat Kreitlow, who is the managing editor of the UpNorthNews, and also is a Cayman 27 alumnus, and Jason Maddux, the former press and journal editor, and my former boss at the Portage Daily Register. We'll hear from Jason about kind of his experiences and his newspaper's experiences through the COVID-19 pandemic. So, without further ado, let's just open it up to this. We probably wouldn't be having this discussion if journalism in some respects wasn't in trouble. And so let me just run down the line and ask some of you, what do you think is the biggest challenge facing journalism right now? And maybe how do we overcome some of those obstacles? April, I hate to put you on the spot, but you're already kind of punched up on my screen here. Do you want to take that one first?
So I would have answered this very differently a couple days ago, but I had a conversation with my 14-year-old last night. She showed me a tweet. It was about a report of police shooting and killing an autistic child. And there was no attribution, no source, no nothing. And I said, how do we know this is true? Like, where does it come from? The thing that gave me hope was she said, oh, Mom, it's Twitter. I mean, I'm going to have to go look it up and see if it really happened. I was just pointing out to you, if that's true, that's a terrible thing. So instead of my normal, the state of my world, I did feel a little bit of hope, because my biggest fear is that people are consuming only the content that they feel like, when they feel like, with no balance at all. And so the biggest challenge for me is that you can get content anywhere with no filters, no vetting. It's just whatever people want to broadcast. It's also, I think, the thing that is good as well. So my issue is I'm just torn between the freedom of expression and content and the need to have, people who are paid to make sure that you have balanced content.
Sure, I can jump in. And let me know if you can't hear me or if I'm experiencing any technical issues, as they were. Following on from what April said, there is a place in the world for the unvetted content, as well as what we call credible journalism. I remember going to my grandmother's house, and she loved her National Enquirer. That said, my father had a copy of the newspaper every morning, and we would sit down and watch the 7 o'clock news every evening. So there is a place for both aspects. When we talk about the biggest challenge that I think is facing the industry, I think it's that people don't understand or appreciate how much work goes into the actual production and execution of balanced, unbiased, vetted news. And so when that lack of understanding is not there, it lends itself to a lack of will, and I'm going to say lack of political will, to make sure that there are mechanisms in place that we continue to have credible journalism within the country. And we do need that credible journalism, because that is how a functioning democracy works. So I think that's the biggest challenge, a basic lack of understanding as to how important credible journalism is and why we need to keep it going.
Kevin, I'll take a slightly different approach than what April and Tammi, which I agree with both of them, and that's access to media and journalism. You know, when Cayman 27 existed, it had a free over-the-air component. Right now, people are consuming their media and their news from the internet. What about the people that don't have access to the internet? There's a significant population percentage in Cayman that doesn't have access to internet at the same sort of capabilities that we're sharing right here. They may have it on a smartphone. They may not even have it on a smartphone. And so there needs to be some thought about how content is delivered, the availability of it, and whether or not it's free or paid to get it. For example, the government television station isn't on all of the cable networks. So if you're fortunate to be able to see that, you might get some content. If you're on a different cable network, you can't see CIGTV. You might be able to listen to Radio Cayman, which is really the only source of free accessible news and media across the country. And so I think we need to think about how it's delivered and how people get their content in order to begin to think about the various types and varieties of contents. I think getting a, you know, being able to watch the news like Tammi talked about and reading the paper is absolutely critical to a democracy as well as a thriving economy.
Yeah, I would just jump in and say I agree with everything that's been said. We're in a competition for people's time, and we've been in a competition for people's time for many years. People just don't. They need to be intrigued by what we're doing. They need to be moved by what we're doing. They need to be informed by what we're doing. And we can, there's a lot of details that go into that, but there are just a lot of options for, not in media. It's not even a competition for other media necessarily. In my view, it's just a competition for playing a game on an app on your phone or reading something or viewing something that we're producing that is, makes them want to, you know, take that minute or two to do it. And you know, I think we've, That's another huge challenge because everything, as someone pointed out, you know, people want to read what they want to, they agree with, not necessarily what they need to know. And we could talk for a couple hours about that. But I think it's the competition that I've seen for many years, not just in recent years with social media, but for many years, just for people to take time to use our products.
Patrick or Pat, do you want to jump in?
Sure. I think the biggest challenge for journalism really boils down to it's a revenue problem. And there are a lot of issues in terms of competing for people's time and making sure that they get the product you're producing. But if you don't have a good business model for generating the revenue you need, then you really don't have an organization and you don't have a chance to address all these other kinds of issues. So I think now is the time for a lot of experimentation going on, and different models will work for different markets and in different places. And I think now it's kind of exciting to see how we can generate enough revenue through various means in order to produce the kind of journalism that society needs in a sustainable way. So to me, it just comes down to dollar and cents before you can address anything else.
And Pat, do you want to round out on this question?
I'll bring up the rear first with any apologies for any signal glitches here, because I hear things cut in and out up here. And every other aspect that I would have brought up has been taken, the business model, the digital divide, although I would add to that, I think many countries are way overdue to treat digital access like a utility. We work to get electricity to everybody, to get running water to everybody. We are way overdue in many countries to get, digital service and good speed digital service to everybody. The only other thing I'll try to squeeze in here in terms of challenges, which isn't at the top of the list, but it hasn't been mentioned yet, is the model of delivery has gone from gatekeeper. In other words, as April was saying, the news you need versus the news you want. we've now moved into FOMO, you know, fear of missing out. And so we've got to get this, even if we haven't checked out everything yet. The sooner we can get more newsrooms and media houses to find the middle ground in between gatekeeper and FOMO is good storytelling. And you may not be first, but if you're telling the best, most complete, most accurate, most colorful story, there's going to be room for you most of the time. And the only other thing I would add is on governance, because it was something that we talked about years ago when I was down there, is in a small area, a small advertising market where there will not be the advertising support, it is on government to be about making sure that all voices can be heard, whether that was an original BBC funding model of subscriptions or some outward government support that can't be tainted by politics. One of those things has to be, I think, reformed, embraced, and strengthened for media in Cayman to flourish in the future.
And if I could pick up on that, Pat, that's exactly right. And that's what I meant by political will in order to put in the mechanisms. It's not about a handout from government. What we need to ensure is that the integrity of journalism isn't compromised, but making sure that those mechanisms, that the legislation is in place to allow some kind of model, which in turn speaks to what Patrick was talking about, the business model for this market. We're talking about a market that is very, very small in size. When we look at the US, and I look at a stat here that I picked up from an article that was shared with me by another former colleague of ours, Ben Mead, who isn't with us today due to unforeseen circumstances on this panel. But, you know, we were talking last night and he shared with me this article. More than 2,000 newspapers have closed in the US since 2004. And that's only being enhanced now or exacerbated rather by the COVID situation. So that's in the US where we're talking about, you know, different size markets and a lot of them are much, much larger than the Cayman Islands. When you don't have a large market to sustain a business model that is completely and 100% funded, if you will, if I use that word, the revenue coming in is from private sector. You need the government to put in mechanisms that protects the fourth estate of democracy. And unfortunately, through successive administrations, that has not come to pass in the Cayman Islands. You know, Bob's here with us. Bob would have gone through the same situation. I remember, look, it was April, Kevin, you, and myself, when Bob was there as CEO of WestStar, and we were in the whole save local television mode, because we saw the writing on the wall from then that, you know, unless a mechanism was put in place to facilitate, and Pat, you were on the ground as well at that time, we just could not continue. And unfortunately, the worst came to pass for Cayman 27. And if we're not careful, the same thing could happen where other media entities in the Cayman Islands, longstanding media entities in the Cayman Islands, will be compromised or will succumb. We can look at, and we are actively looking at digital models. But again, to pick up on what Bob said earlier, I'm thinking of Granny in Northside, who all she has is her physical compass paper, her physical Caymanian Times, or when she used to tune into Cayman 27, free to air. And in Cayman, we have a very unique situation where we have to juggle the forward-looking view of you know, going completely digital and making sure that access is happening, as well as making sure that those who don't have that yet, that they do get it, and in the various formats in which they need. They need it.
So one thing, as I jump in, as I always do, I need to go back quickly, though, to address something that Bob said that I think is important, but I want to make clear. I did check to make sure that the government channel was available on all the cable providers. It is. They all have it. It's not the issue of whether content is available on a cable system that's the challenge in this day and time. I think the challenge is more really about having, and I work for government, and it's a great job. I love Radio Cayman. They give us a lot of leeway and freedom. Don't stand over me and look at my scripts and criticize. That doesn't happen. Yeah, I thought it would, it didn't. But I still think it's very important to have an independent, freestanding news organization that is available in different ways to different people as they need it. And look, if we were willing to all work for free and do this as volunteers, it might be a very different game. But for us, this isn't a hobby. It may be a passion, but it's not a hobby. This was our career choice, our livelihood. And we all believe very strongly in doing it, but we also, like anyone else, have families who need to be taken care of, bills that need to be paid. And I think it's important to recognize, as Tammi said, the size of the market that we're in. It is a small market. And some of the biggest portions of potential revenue come from entities that here don't advertise. You know, the accounting firms, lawyers, doctors, there may be some advertising in pockets, but not at the level you would see in the US, for example, even proportionally. And now let's not forget that any entity that's commercial in nature and advertising is their model, they're now competing with Google and Facebook ads. And it's just a completely different game than it was even 10 years ago. So if you need money, it has to come from somewhere.
So Tammi, while I agree with everything that you've said, let me just play devil's advocate for a moment. You know, you'll hear people out there who say, listen, this is a private institution. This is a privately owned business. You know, government shouldn't be involved, as they don't get involved in most private businesses. You know, what would you say to people who take that point of view?
So, and that's exactly it, right? It's a balance that I was talking about, ensuring that we're able to maintain the integrity of journalism. And that means for it to be an independent, freestanding entity, but enabling the execution of it, the production of it to happen. And as April talked about and others, it's not free. We have to feed our families too. And the amount of production, even for papers, video, what have you, there's so much that goes into it and a skill set that's necessary. So you need to be able to pay for the salaries, you need to be able to pay for the overheads, you need to be able to pay for the equipment, especially for a digital/video format. What we're talking about when I say mechanisms is creating something like what the BBC model works on, or the PBS model, where perhaps there is, and you know, Bob would know this all too well, and April, in the case of what was there for television, or what we were talking about for television, a universal fund, where the cable/internet providers would pay towards a pool so that they could create, a pool that would then lend itself to the creation of local content. Now, Cayman 27 at the time was the only entity that was creating that local content that ticked all the boxes as to what local content constitutes. So that legal framework would have been there, the universe, and that would have been where government came into play, making sure that, yes, internet providers, you are fulfilling your license, because let's not forget, they have a license requirement that mandates them to carry local content. That's not happening, because even on the floor of the House, the Legislative Assembly, the Premier himself said that government information services, the television or the video component that comes out of that entity, the government TV station, does not constitute local content. So there is a requirement for that local content to be carried. So when we talk about that framework, that's what I'm referring to in terms of creating a mechanism through which they can fulfill their license. It would go into a fund, so they would pay towards this fund, and then that in turn would go towards the local content provider. So that was what they were looking at for, in the most simplistic terms, what they were looking for at the where the television component was concerned. In terms of the newspaper, well, Kev, you used to have it. There was a requirement to advertise in the newspaper, right? As part of job, when you were looking for someone to fill a job, you had to advertise in the local paper. That there's a mechanism as well. That was helping you get revenue coming in through the doors and would help pay towards the salaries and the overheads that the newspaper has. Once that requirement was taken away for that advertisement to take place in the local newspaper, that was like taking food out of the mouths of some of you, in my opinion, to put it in a more drastic term. So when we talk about the political will or government doing what it needs to do to help journalism survive, the kind of journalism we're talking about, credible, unbiased, balanced, factual, vetted journalism, that's what we're talking about, creating mechanisms to enable those entities to continue to function.
And that's critical. The government doesn't need to spend the money. What Tammi described exists, for example, in the United States, where those getting a television license, NBC, are required to broadcast news. And they're required to broadcast impartial news as part of their license. Or if you're submitting a legal notice, somebody died, an obituary, those things that require publications, they have to be in a printed newspaper. So there are mechanisms for government to ensure media and the mediums stay viable and profitable without picking sides, without funding them. But the Cayman government has to decide it wants to do that. It has to decide it has a priority to ensure that the public has access to information in multiple formats, in multiple ways. And Tammi hit the nail right on the head. It's all in the political will. If Cayman 27 would be alive today if the rules that were in place were enforced and every cable company had to carry local content. But again, it wasn't the political will. And the country made a different choice, both with television and now with the Compass. And, you know, we're going to end up getting our news on Twitter and have to go to April's news media source to digest what is real and what is not.
Just speaking from the
Jason,
U.S.
Jason, I cut you off before. Go ahead.
No. Just speaking from the U.S. perspective, I'm interested. This is a fascinating conversation for me because there are media outlets throughout this country that are trying to figure out how to have the proper funding model. And I, from a newspaper perspective, I think very few newspapers want the government involved. I mean, we take money from. You're right. The obituaries are not a requirement of being published in almost any newspaper that I'm aware of, but legal notices are. And every state in this country, basically, there are lawmakers are trying to stop that, saying that we don't need to publish these in newspapers. We can put them online. And I could talk about that for quite a while. I won't bore you with the details, but it's just a different perspective here when our government and our president says that the journalists are an enemy of the state. I mean, it's very difficult for us to. I'm still stunned by this, you know, and it's going on for almost 4 years now, but I think most journalists here would like to figure out, is there a way to do a PBS, you know, a membership model of newspapers in the United States? I'm not hopeful of that. And I don't want to be a pessimist. I mean, I did lose my job. Our paper closed down. I've been open since 1854. I've been owned by the same family for half a century. The oldest business in my community. It doesn't exist. The advertising just wasn't there. And that was mostly due because of the coronavirus challenges that we had. But what makes me concerned is if we're putting out a great product, why are people not consuming it in the way that we think they should be? Why?
And I want to get to that in one moment, Jason, because I've got an idea of potentially what it might be or one of the components. But before we do that, since we're talking about financial models, before we move on to the next topic, Patrick, tell me a little bit about what you're doing with the Cayman Current. It's a nonprofit, and tell me how that works, because I know that this is something that's happening not only with you, but outside of Cayman as well.
Yeah, so I started the Cayman Current. It's a nonprofit journalism organization focused on education in the Cayman Islands. So we don't rely on the two main streams of revenue that for-profit media would. So we don't do subscriptions and we don't do display advertising. We're 100% funded by donations. And I've been in Cayman for about 9 years. The first half of my career was in the United States, and I have worked for nonprofit digital publications in the past. And I have some friends and colleagues who work for major multi-million dollar nonprofit organizations like the Texas Tribune and ProPublica, et cetera. So I've been watching this model develop over the past 15 years in the United States very closely. And I thought that it held promise for a country like the Cayman Islands, because even though our population is small, the dollar amounts are relatively big. And also it's an area that we don't have a lot of international media coverage on Cayman. So if we don't cover the news in Cayman ourselves, nobody else is gonna do it for us.
And to be clear, you're focused on education in the Cayman Islands, right? That's what your entity will be honed in on.
Correct. And we launched last Tuesday. I started raising money and getting the word out in June, and had a really, really positive response from the community, and raised enough money to launch The Current. We're focused exclusively on education. And one interesting thing about The Current is all of our content is free on our website and social media. So we don't have any paywalls, no subscriptions to caymancurrent.org. And not only that, but all of our content is free for republication by any other news media organization, as long as they credit us. So you can think of us as like an Associated Press style wire service as well.
I was just about to say like a wire service. Yeah, I was just about to say like a wire service with a particular niche on focused on education. And that's great. And I hope that model works and you can continue to facilitate news where education is concerned, because Lord alone knows that we do need that focus on education. I'll be the first one to put my hand up and say, absolutely need it, and we need to
perform.
But then there's all these other areas that also need, you know, a report on the ground for, to make sure that they're being covered. What happens to those, right? And who's gonna step in to make sure that we have vetted, accurate, unbiased news reporting in those areas?
Well, you know, it's interesting when we've talked about, you know, hyper-local coverage is something I've always thought was important, because, again, if you don't cover a small community, who does? If you live in a community of, you know, 60,000 people like here or you know, Portage, Wisconsin, where Jason and I worked, which is, what, 10,000 people, if we don't cover the stories happening there, nobody covers them. But I wonder if Patrick is maybe onto something, and these other entities are onto something here, where maybe hyper-local coverage isn't linked to geography anymore. Maybe it's about a theme, right? Digging deep into education, digging deep into, you know, whatever it might be. And I wrote to you, Patrick, and I mean this sincerely. I hope that this takes off, because this will bode well for all journalists and journalism in general. You know, and this is probably my point in time as the managing editor of the Cayman Compass, which just last week launched a paywall, to talk a little bit about why we did that. And really, it's quite simple, which is to say, other revenue streams are declining, and we've talked about, you know, some various reasons for that. And at the end of the day, we felt like we should get paid for the service that we provide. I know it's a very simplistic view, but, you know, you don't go to a coffee shop and expect to get the coffee for free. That's a very, very simplistic view of the whole thing. But that essentially is what it boils down to. So, you know, it's been interesting. We've received some emails, a lot of emails of support. We've received some that were well-reasoned and telling us why they're not going to do it. And then we've received a very small portion of just, you know, I don't know if I'd call it hate mail, but, you know, it's bordering on it. But anyway, and so far, so good. So I just wanted to take that opportunity to kind of explain from our perspective why that happened. So you guys, we're about a half an hour in. Go ahead, Bob.
I was going to say, you know, as you've pointed out, and knowing, you know, a history with you and Tammi and April, good journalism is expensive. It takes a lot of money. And while it's great to have a lot of resources, you know, at the end of the day, there's one PBS television station in a metropolitan area or a city, not 10. And, you know, the cable companies in America all got together to collectively fund C-SPAN. And there needs to be some thought, leadership from government to help create and make sure that the media and the mediums can survive. You know, that there should be a herding or a funneling so that there is a profitable television station, a profitable online news outlet, a profitable print media. And again, not necessarily needing government funding, but needing government requirements. Just like schools require people to get vaccinated before they can attend, the government isn't paying for your vaccination, but they're making a requirement. And really the Cayman government needs to decide that it wants this, it wants good journalism, it wants hyper-local. That's all there is in Cayman is hyper-local. I guess you could say, you know, if you got really, this is the West Bay edition of something, but, you know, it comes back to making sure that the government, you know, wants this.
So let me take a moment. Oh, actually, yes, April, you've had your hand raised.
Go ahead. The question I haven't have struggled with for more years than I care to recall. We're looking at government to solve the problem in a way, right? To provide some sort of support to it. But much like making sure the content is relevant and significant to people who you want to pay for it, why is it important for government to make sure that happens in our society? I think that case needs to be made more consistently. If I put myself in the government's shoes for a minute, they're going to say, look, we have Radio Cayman in place, we have a CIG TV in place, and you know, regular media is private enterprise. I don't believe this in my heart, but I can see why they would make that case. And anytime they interfere in private media in any capacity, they're going to get criticized for it, right? So I think we all have to make the case for why, aside from the government-provided sources of content, independent media matters. And why it's worth paying for some way, somehow. I just think that sometimes we assume everyone gets why this is important for them on a daily basis when we don't always make the case for ourselves.
And I think you can look at the United States, whichever way you sway in the political understanding of that country, and look at what if the party in power controlled the media. You know, that could be, you know, look at the current, you know, touchy issues in Cayman that are being debated today, such as the domestic partnership legislation. And that government's going to tell one story. And the media is going to tell another story. And it's important that both sides get told, because if it's just the government telling the story, you're never going to get the story. So maybe it's stepping back even further, April, to ensure that, you know, stealing from the Washington Post, democracy dies in darkness. And it needs to have, you know, the reason the media is called the fourth estate or the fourth branch of government or however you look at it is because it is that important. And it is not, you know, an afterthought. It is, you can't have a functioning democracy without it.
So I just wanted to point out.
Go ahead, Tam. We'll go Tammi and then Jason.
Jason, that's okay? Yeah, that's okay? All right, so it was just two things I wanted to point out. So again, this article that our colleague Ben Mead had pointed me to, it was about a book written by a journalist. Her name is Margaret Sullivan, and it was called Ghosting the News, Local Journalism and the Crisis of American Democracy. And in it, she basically describes how once you erode journalism, and we talk about the why, once journalism becomes eroded, what ends up happening is that you have a news desert that springs up. And with that rubbing away of journalism and the credible journalism that is, you have almost tribalism that takes place because there's a disenfranchisement of people. They become less interested in what's actually happening on the ground where their country's concerned, and it impacts how they end up voting. So when we talk about democracy being impacted, this is what we mean. because they don't have the unbiased, vetted, sourced news to make discerning as much as possible opinions about where they want their country to go. And that's where tribalism takes place. And if you didn't think we had tribalism in the Cayman Islands before, because we talk about how that's how, you know, the majority of people would vote, watch what happens if we start taking away more and more of our media entities, our journalism entities.
I would just add to that, that I don't know what percentage of our residents or media consumers, or maybe not media consumers, because they probably do feel this way, but I don't know what percentage of residents of any place where you are or in my state feel the same way about journalism and good journalism that you just stated, Bob, before. I just don't know that. I mean, I think we have to convince people of that. So what does that say? I mean, I don't know. These are questions I've grappled with for a lot of years. I mean, in Pennsylvania, we were the best weekly newspaper in the entire state. Multiple times. In the last year, when we went out of business, we had just been named a few months earlier the best weekly paper of any size in the state of Pennsylvania. There is a news desert now. We're in that community, and people are not going to get the information that they need. But I don't know how much. It pains me to say this. I'm the editor of the paper. I was the editor of the paper there. How is that going to manifest itself in their lives? Again, I'm asking questions I don't have the answers to, and this is what this makes such a difficult conversation, is that I don't know if people are engaged or just care that much. And it might be a very different situation in where you all are. But I mean, that's why I talked about competition for time. People would rather play Candy Crush. I mean, and so I don't know how you change that around. That's not a tiny little sailboat you're trying to turn the other direction. That is a massive battleship that takes forever to turn around. And I don't know the answer, and it's sad.
You question the merits of
I think there's
worth all that, you know, some days. You're like, why am I doing this? Nobody really cares.
Yeah, 100%.
And so here's the thing. You know, the public's trust in the media is at an all-time low. You know, if you go onto the Pew Center and you look at some of their media statistics. I mean, and especially, and I don't want to blame it on him, but ever since the advent of the phrase fake news, I mean, there's just been a huge decline in everybody's trust of the media. The two probably most profitable media outlets in the United States aren't even hiding anymore their bias. And I'm talking about CNN and Fox News at that point. So I think part of the problem just is a lack of understanding and a lack of trust of the media, because, you know, we all sit here, I'm assuming all of us either went to journalism school, and if we didn't, we surely, you know, cut our teeth in the whatever media outlet we were working at, and we understand how important it is to cover government, even though sometimes that may be boring, how important it is to attribute facts to someone or something, even though some, we'll just call it new age media outlets, don't feel the need to do that and make sweeping, you know, statements that people just take as fact. So I think part of the issue is, we've done ourselves a disservice over the past, you know, several decades of not going out, not letting people know why what we do is important, because we've always known it. And it's what we went to school for, and it, you know, got drilled into our heads when we were in Journalism 101. But I think maybe we take for granted that we have that kind of insight. And so what I would like to do, and what I would like to see is some sort of structure by which we can let the public know why what we do and how we do it maybe is more important, and why that's so crucial to a well-run democracy.
I would just say in the United States, newspapers never promoted themselves. As a matter of fact, it was the opposite. I mean, when in the 40s and 50s and 60s and 70s and 80s, when companies were making 30 and 40 and 50% profit every year, why would you promote yourself? It was the opposite of what you wanted to do. You wanted to stay, you know, you were just reflecting the news. So we have no history in the United States of promoting ourselves. None. We have no, it's not part of our culture in the newspapers, and we are so far behind that we still let other people tell the narratives of what we do. TV and radio have been better at it in the United States, but newspapers, I can tell you, not good. We have no culture of it, and we are way behind, and that's one of the reasons why we're getting stomped on. We never promoted ourselves. A, we didn't have to, and B, we thought it was kind of sketchy because of our overall mission of being an impartial, even promoting ourselves felt somehow not I'm not sure what word I would use, not
Right, like you tell the news, don't make the news kind of a thing.
Right.
We're not the story. So I would say it's not just the United States. I think that's, we're not the story. It's drilled into our heads. We are the vehicles through which we do the storytelling, but we are not the story. But now we have to become the story in a sense if we want to survive. And I say we in terms of journalists.
I just want to interject you quickly because I do have, I am, as we speak, writing stories and preparing for a press conference because I have to, we're that small, right? But I did work at several TV markets in the US at different parts. And I always say I was the latecomer to the scene. I always showed up right when the makeup artist and the money train left the building. And I walked right in right after. And there was an era where we spent more time showcasing how we were doing the news stories than actually doing the news stories, that while it might have sold us a little bit to the public, in the end, the product itself was not of the caliber to sustain the public's interest. And in some ways, I think we made it worse because we further fed the short attention span that people already had. So
that was in the United States? That was when you're in the States. Yeah,
fact over substance. And this was more specifically in the local news markets because I never really worked at a national level. So I would find that I would spend 35 minutes on the actual story, the rest of the time doing promos, teases, all these other things around it. So I feel like in some ways we've been chasing our tails in some respects, trying to figure out the answer to the increasing short attention span of our audience. And sometimes our news isn't relevant. We're just trying to fill the gap, the hole today for them without making sure that the stories do actually matter to them. And some stuff is boring, right? Some important stuff is actually boring, but it doesn't mean it doesn't need to be done. And I think that conflict has caused me great pain because I would actually rather play, well, maybe not Candy Crush, but I'd actually rather play a video game or watch a soap opera than actually read a legal brief. But I have to read the legal brief in order to help make sense of it for someone else who can't do that. And if I'm spending all day on that, there's about 7 other news stories that didn't get done that day. So the very nature, at least in electronic media, of what we do is just plain old difficult. And the Cayman market is small. It is a small market. You only have so many people in the newsroom at a time, and they're usually doing 4 or 5 different jobs. So in some respects, it's not just money. It's the right kind of people surrounding and supporting. If you don't have a lawyer on staff, do you really want to risk covering some of these really controversial issues and messing it up? Lawyers are not free either. So I say it's not just money, but it's money to fund what needs to be there for a holistic journalistic enterprise. And some of this is entertainment that we do as well. It's not just news and information. And I worry about that a bit because we've just gotten addicted to fast, funny, curious, quick, extreme. And anything that takes a little more effort than that as consumers, we just kind of don't bother with. And that worries me.
There's enough money in Cayman to support it all. It just needs to be properly focused. It needs to be properly corralled. And in the absence of any guidelines or regulations or requirements, it doesn't get concentrated enough to support any one entity. Because it is inexpensive to throw up a video channel on YouTube compared to what Cayman 27 was. But if I go back to what Tammi said, if political will is there, you can have a print paper, you can have a free over-the-air television station. You know, you can do it. It just requires it to be the political will. And it's not, you know, yeah, there's a lot of cost to this, but it has to be in a little market funneled into. And in the United States, it has little markets and it doesn't let 20 TV stations exist in Appleton, Wisconsin. It doesn't let 5 cable networks, you know, exist in Minocqua, Wisconsin. And so to look at that, government in the United States has not funded things, but it's allowed a certain level of existence to occur to make sure that it happens. And that is missing in Cayman.
And let me just add one thing that we have lost when we talk about these entities closing down. and, you know, the lack of support. I don't know if it's fully understood or comprehended just yet what the loss of the TV station, the only local independent TV station, means in terms of training and upskilling in this market, in this country, in this jurisdiction, young Caymanians in the ways of video production, in journalism, in operating different levels of equipment. We have lost that. We don't have that anymore. The number of young people.
Tammi, I think I see a different story. I want to believe what you're saying because of my history with Cayman 27. But I see young people getting jobs in video production, even in government. I see, you know, tons of training programs and stuff online. I think there are training opportunities for young people, but what is the sense of training me to be a television reporter when there's no television? do you understand? Right.
But in terms of journalism, like, I learned everything from you. I'm talking to my teacher right now in terms of how I conducted myself as a video reporter, right? When we took that away, that is now not there. And I'm talking about for the young Caymanians who may not have access.
The journalism aspect, I agree with you completely on. There are no opportunities really in that space, except for maybe, you know, what the company's doing, right?
And when I talk about video production, I'm talking about the holistic sense, the teamwork, how the camera works with, how they all work together. And how the whole running, the whole operation runs. And if you wanted to even do that on a digital format, how it all comes together. We've lost, that's what I'm talking about. It's easy to just train somebody on a camera.
Yeah, we lost that version. I don't believe going back to that is the right way either. I'm not sure that we have the right answer, but I ultimately think that there is a future vision that we just haven't, as media people, been able to figure out yet, that touches on all of those things in the new world that we live in.
These challenges have been around for a lot of years, and they're ramping up. I don't know what the answer, our answer keeps changing, and that's gonna happen to some extent. I think what's frustrating is something looks good for, in the United States, everybody pivoted to video, and that was proven to be a big nothing. I mean, I don't think it's been monetized in a way that's going to mean anything to anybody. And it's basically been, you know, so we keep, you know, we move around and we try these things, but we don't stick with them because it is expensive. And we've said all that, we've each said that in our own way, but we asked people, we told people, my weekly newspaper said, you know, we're struggling and we're just going to flat out ask you for money. We want you to donate money to us. You're never going to see it again. We want money from you to stay in float. And we were shocked by how much we got, but you know, it was like, $13,000. That didn't even cover payroll. I mean, that's a nothing for the expenses that we have as an organization. So, you know, it's just, I've been answering these questions have been around for a lot of years, and it's just they've ramped to the point now in the United States where, as you pointed out, I mean, a lot of newspapers got out of business since 2004, and they're going to continue to go out of business. And the ones that do stay in business are going to be on shoestring budgets with just ghosts of staff that are nothing compared to what they used to be. And I don't know what the answer to that is. It's not like I'm an expert in it, but I've been asking myself these questions for many, many, many years. Do we have to write boring stories? If they're boring, is it our fault? Or is it just by the very nature of what's in them, not going to be interesting? And if they're not interesting, then why are we writing them? Because somebody needs to know.
I was just going to say quickly, Kevin, that to the point just made, you know, somebody came up to me and said, where are all the financial services stories? Where we talk, you know, Cayman right now is still, unfortunately, on a blacklist. And this is somebody in that all-important sector to us asking me, where's the coverage? Now, maybe there is some level of coverage. That person's not seeing it. And we talk about the small market. Even within that market, there are different demographics, people looking for different things. you know, how does journalism in a market like this be all things to all people? And how do we make sure that we are creating journalistic content that is going to be consumed, that is interesting to all the different people that we have to serve?
Well, and that's the thing. I don't think we can be all things to all people. You know, there's plenty of times when I'm sitting right here at this desk or working from home more recently where, you know, we might get beat on a story and it's a really interesting story and I see people sharing it all over Facebook. But part of the problem is because we have a certain set of you know, journalistic standards whereby we need to confirm information and make sure we have it exactly right, because making an error in real journalism is, you know, the worst thing that you can do. But again, I'm not so sure that people care, to go back to what Jason said earlier, because, you know, we see, we'll say citizen journalism, where, you know, somebody grabs a camera and a microphone and goes out and they might have it up first and it might be, you know, just the craziest story you've ever seen, and it gets all kind of shares and hits. And then at the end of the day, it turns out it was wrong, or it was partially wrong. But they still got a ton of exposure because they don't have to, or they choose not to adhere to maybe the same standards that other media outlets do. And in that way, I feel disadvantaged because we're trying to do the right thing, but it almost feels like we're being penalized for that.
Mm-hmm. So now we're just completely depressed because, you know, journalism doesn't matter. But in spite of the difficulty and the challenges, and I guess the audience may not realize that most of us know each other pretty well, and I have a history of arguing back and forth about these things because in some ways it helps me redefine and explore how I feel about them. But, you know, I don't want anyone for a moment to think that I don't believe that journalism is critical for the society. I don't think that any journalistic entity is going to get it 100% right 100% of the time. I just have some deep-seated concerns about where society is and how easy it is for us to let go something that is important, you know, for the development of the country, in order to just look at the fastest, newest, you know, sexiest little thing on our phone, leaving behind. You know, Tammi, I gave you a little bit of grief about the training, but in my heart, it was the people-to-people experience that was the most important part.
Yes.
It was having someone more experienced than you sitting with you, working through the ideas, the concerns.
That's the training ground I'm talking about. How many times was I in your office going through the stories, making sure that, Tammi, did you check this? Did you check this? Did you check this? We're talking about years. And then I passed that on, right? I paid it forward. And that was happening not just with me, but with others. And my real concern, and you can see that this really hurts my heart, that's not happening anymore. And yeah. Should the worst come to pass,
you know, you right,
yeah,
is it, you know, is,
yeah, I hear you. My, I mean, I'm older, so we'll be okay in the end.
You know, Cayman is a market of 50,000 people. There's enough money. There's enough talent to have world-class journalism, world-class television, world-class newspapers. Again, it comes back to the political will. And I'll give you a completely different example. Recently in the Compass, there's been stories about another submarine cable. Well, the nation of Palau, 10,000 people, is getting its second submarine cable. Why? Because they have a focused effort. And the entire country and everything is about doing that because it has some benefits. And again, I think if government, if Tammi was, you know, queen for a day, the right rules and regulations would exist to ensure that there's profitable media. And it's doable. It's there. Until April and Tammi, you know, move away or depart, you know, we've got talent. That's not what we need. We need the focus to make it happen. And in small towns in America, they've lost a lot of newspapers. But some small towns had their newspapers bought by Tribune Company or others or Scripps, and they continue on as part of something else. So yeah, there's economics. And Jason, your story is more of an economic challenge than it is a news challenge. And it's really making sure that you know, at the end of the day, there is a focus and there is a choice and there is that political will, and helping people understand why having all these choices and this kind of media is important.
And I think I'm envious a little bit of the situation there, because you are a market of a certain size. I mean, we're so fragmented in the United States. A smaller market is part of a bigger market is part of a bigger market. And it sounds like there you have something that's a little bit more graspable. It is such an overwhelming challenge here in the United States that it's, I don't want to be depressing about it. I agree with what April said. I still feel positive. People need to know, have good journalism as part of their lives, but to monetize it, and I wish Patrick the best as well. People want to be affirmed or confirmed and not informed. And that's something that's been around, saying has been around for a while, but man, it is just so true.
So Jason, question, if you any idea on how to change that and make it where people have that desire to be informed? Because information has never been more in demand. And that's really the funny thing about this conversation we're having. It's never been more in demand, yet the people who distribute the information, at least the traditional models are struggling. So any idea on how to maybe change that mindset from, you know, in our audience?
You know, I wish I had a better answer for you. I think part of it is, like they said, we call it marketing, but I think it's just telling people how important we are. And sometimes it's hard to convince people that something's important in their lives until it's gone. And honestly, we've been closed for a couple months now. I don't think we've had an overwhelming, you know, flow of, you know, oh, we really, really miss you guys. We have to do better at telling people why we're important. And showing them and saying, look, we reported on this and that led to this. We reported on the mayor saying this or taking this action, and this is what happened. This is how it affected you. And we would try to do that through editorials, but, you know, and we did it through marketing. We promoted ourselves, but the challenge is, and again, that's why publications or endeavors like Patrick's, I think, are intriguing, because you are filling a niche. And when you're a general information publication like our newspaper was, it is hard to please everybody. And I think that's one of the challenges. So the easy answer for me to say would be, if I had the answer, I'd still be employed. It's a very big challenge that I'm not depressed about, but I'm not hopeful for. I guess I'd put it that way. I don't see what the best case scenario for newspapers is in the United States.
It's really difficult, because we talk. You say, you know, if you had done a better job of promoting yourselves and the work that you're doing, it might have been a different outcome.
Maybe,
but I think people's memories are short. I think that even when we have made life altering, progressive, positive change as a result of the work that we've done, people forget, you know, Watergate is bandied about, right? But a more recent example is the Miami Herald's role in the Epstein case, right? A lot of people don't realize it was that investigative journalism and one female reporter's relentless passion, if you will, her pursuit to get to the truth, even in the face of adversity, you know, that so much was uncovered and we know where that landed up. Locally here in the Cayman Islands, if I think of one case where as a result of the reporting that we did effected change without, you know, going into names or that kind of thing, but there was a murder about 10 years ago and it led to the closure of what we call the prison farm. It was an unsecured perimeter and that's where the murder had taken place. It was a very upsetting case, sordid case, but the reason why I bring it up, it was a result of the reporting that was done that led to, you know, a closer eye on this situation and then ultimately the closure of the farm so that kind of unsecured situation wouldn't happen again. So that can happen and we report it and in the moment it's like, hey, great, you know, that entity, you know, shone the spotlight on that. But then people forget. So I think people's memories are short, unfortunately. When it comes to remembering.
I also think it's a case. Sorry, Tammi. I also think it's a case too. And I realize we're an hour in, guys. So if you need to pop off because you've got a meeting coming up, no problem at all. But I just want to say this too. I think part of it is while we all see the importance of reporting on you know, certain things that, you know, we've used the word boring, so let's just keep going with that. You know, we've always been in a position where we tell stories, right? And that is very important. But, you know, maybe part of the answer as well is just kind of listening a bit more also to our audience. And while it doesn't all have to be, you know, stories about puppy dogs and balloons and whatever makes people happy, we have to have serious stuff in there as well. You know, maybe just figuring out a way that is more preferable for our audience in terms of storytelling, or how long stories need to be. Or, you know, I had somebody, very simple, somebody tell me the other day, you know, I'd really love to see just a motivational quote on your website. Because I go there and a lot of it is just, yeah, you know, either negative news or news that isn't necessarily uplifting. I just want to see a positive quote. And, you know, it was kind of like, I never ever would have thought of that. Because I don't look at our website like the average person does. And it was just, you know, kind of an example of maybe it's time to also listen a bit and strike a balance between doing what we do professionally and also providing our audience with what they're looking for.
An interesting thing to me is that more people are reading our content than almost ever in a lot of cases because of the internet. I would argue that newspapers, even today with shoestring staffs, are doing better stories than they've almost ever done on the smaller scale, maybe not metro papers, but smaller papers and communities, because we do know so much more about what our readers are reading. I mean, when I started in this business 25 years ago, your boss would come by and say, hey, nice story. And maybe somebody you wrote about would say, hey, thanks for doing a story. You'd never know who read the story. Now I could tell who was reading every story on our website immediately. So we have catered a lot to what readers want. We used to be like, I don't care. Somebody called in and wants to do a story. I'm not doing a story on that. That's stupid. We have, I think, changed a lot of what we have, you know, how we pursue things, but it still doesn't seem to be enough. I mean, and it's just, it is frustrating, I think, to many of us who have been doing this for a long time that I think we have adapted. I know in the United States, if you look at newspapers in the 70s, 80s, when there was like the heyday, they weren't that great. We're doing better in a lot of cases now than we were then. And people have this memory of newspapers being so great when they were growing up. They weren't. And that's another odd thing about this entire thing. I think a lot of the media outlets, and especially in the United States and newspapers, are doing a very good job and made some better than they've ever done. And it's still not enough.
All right, guys. So if everybody is okay with it, I'm going to wrap up here. We do have that government press conference coming up in an hour. So I know April and I need to get ready and head over there to cover that. But before we go, you know, let me just open it up to kind of closing comments from each of you. Jason, you're already up on my screen. Do you just want to go first?
Yeah, I think it goes back. It's been really nice to talk to everybody today, and the perspectives are wonderful, and I think we all share a lot of the same challenges no matter where we are. I still feel, and it comes back, I think, to something that April said. I mean, people do need this information. The frustrating part to me is I think in a lot of cases we're doing a good job providing it, and it's clear how financially this is a challenge to do good journalism. I don't know what the answer is. I don't know what the best case scenario is for, at least for newspapers in the United States. And you can say the newspaper is an outdated model that, you know, we're just delivering news and the paper part of it is just a conveyance. It's not really what we should be about. But I wouldn't say cautiously optimistic. I'm hopeful that we can figure out a way to do this. In the United States, I don't think it's going to be by the government. I don't see how anybody that's ever going to work. So I think we have some more challenges here. I would say for the discussion that everyone else had, it sounds like there are definitely some opportunities and to grow and maybe get to where you want to be, where you are. So I really am thankful I was part of this conversation. I appreciate the opportunity to do it, Kevin. And I wish everybody the best, because we did choose this not to make a lot of money. We chose this because it spoke to us. And I hope we can continue to do that for a lot of years.
Appreciate it, Jason. Patrick?
Yeah, I just want to, I guess, as perspective context, for the past 100 years or so, there's been a grand bargain with newspapers and other for-profit media where the mission of the news organization has typically been to inform and make society better. not to sell advertisement. And most advertisers aren't really interested in that mission. What they want to do is they want to sell their product. But the thing that they had in common was the news organizations could put their product in front of the eyeballs they needed. So it was always kind of an uneasy marriage. And now that grand bargain is falling apart because there's different ways to reach more people in a more targeted way. So I think the nonprofit model is promising because the purpose of the donations, which is where we get our revenue from, is to further the mission of the organization. And I also think there's promising models in terms of niche subscription publications. And there's also room, I think, in Cayman for at least one general circulation news product that can reach tens of thousands of people. So I think there is, I think the market is good here. And I think that it's good for competition. And I think that we can have several different entities coexisting together and getting people the information and the news that they do need. And I guess just to wrap up, can paraphrase Proust, who said that change necessarily involves the death of something familiar, and that's why people are afraid of it. But if you're not the one, if you're not changing, then you're the one that's dying. So that's even worse. So I think it's time, we just put our hard hats on and get our pickaxes out and just, start scratching away and getting to work and, see what happens. But thanks for having me.
Thank you, Patrick. Really appreciate it.
Thanks,
Tammi? Oh, Pat, you can go ahead. Go ahead, Pat.
Okay, sorry. I've had quite a connection here, and I apologize if I've been cutting in and out. I'm just speaking on behalf of a completely different model, privately funded, and it's political. It is people who saw a niche to fill, that newspapers were dying, but also, as importantly, mainstream newsrooms weren't covering politics anymore. Consultants are telling them, don't cover politics. Your audience thinks it's boring. Well, our funders know that there are people who are interested in political news. They know that there is right-wing media, and they know that there is mainstream media that some people think is liberal, but is not. In other words, it's almost more vanilla to the point of boring. There is a room in the marketplace for actual fact-based news, but that comes from a left of center viewpoint. And that's what we're very upfront about that. And to get eyeballs, means that we are putting money into social media to push our stories out and to do audience acquisition and get them signed up for our newsletters. And we've built rapidly to 20,000 subscribers and growing. So it's a completely different model that somebody a lot smarter than me, and she's a lot younger than me, but she know her stuff. But it's a niche that we knew people wanted to be filled. And I think that whether it works in Cayman or other places, I don't really know. But I do think that we have to be open to a wide range of models where you can still do journalism, but it not be what it was, because what was isn't what it was before. And, everything changes. I'm excited with this new model. And I think you have to be open to the prospects of new ones too. So thanks for letting me be a part of this.
Thanks so much, Pat. Tammi, you want to go?
Say goodbye. So thanks again for this great conversation. So
thank you, Jason. Take care. Bye-bye. Tammi, do you have any closing remarks?
So, I'm just going to reiterate what I said earlier, which is I believe that it is imperative for credible, independent, unbiased, vetted journalism in order to have a functioning democracy. And coming back to your first question about what's the biggest challenge, it's the understanding of what it takes to make sure that happens, the amount of legwork that's needed for whatever the vehicle is, whether it's print, video, digital, there is a level of work, legwork that's necessary to get to that end. And it at times takes multiple bodies. It takes a lot of, it can take a certain amount of resources depending on the medium. So it's that lack of understanding. So again, though, it is imperative for that level of journalism to be present for a democracy to function as it should. And my hope is that the political will, as or and even the social will, let me add on one more adjective, the political and social will is there or manifests itself to make sure that that continues in the Cayman Islands, because we don't need a news desert here.
All right, thank you so much, Tammi. Bob?
You know, whether it's Canada, the United States, the United Kingdom, Japan, all of these countries create an environment to make news journalism successful, whether it's through funding mechanisms like the BBC or requirements of content like the Canadians with the CRTC or unique licenses and other legal requirements like the United States has. So there's mechanisms out there, and it's the Cayman Islands is certainly a big enough marketplace and a talented enough marketplace that it really just needs to, and these are not big changes, they're tweaks, and it's a will of the people aspect to create the right structure so that private, profitable journalism can not just survive, but thrive. And it's dual. It's, you know, we're so close, but, you know, it's just government has to want to do it. Maybe it's the next government or the next government after that. But it will get there because the need is always going to be there.
All right. Thank you, Bob. And April Cummings with Radio Cayman was on with us, but I think that April's probably heading over to the government press conference. So again, I want to thank April and all of you and everybody who joined us today for this amazing conversation. Super glad we were able to have it. Thanks so much, guys.
Thank you, Kevin.
All right. And with that, we are going to wrap up today's Ask the Experts roundtable. I'm Kevin Morales, editor-in-chief with the Cayman Compass. We thank you so much for tuning in and watching this. If you tuned in about halfway and you want to check out the beginning, this will be uploaded in its entirety on our Cayman Compass Facebook page as well as the Cayman Compass YouTube page, so you can go check it out there. I also want to remind our audience that we will be live streaming the government press conference coming up in about 45 minutes, so be sure to check back for that. Thanks again for tuning in. Have a great day.
For all the Zoom hashouts and recipe tryouts, the world changed, and we were right there, standing with you, always near, getting closer in so many ways, laughing together as we face these days. And because we are Caribbean, we've got a special insight that tells us there's no need to worry, world. We'll be all right.